I'm Robert Rodriguez, and you're watching Up Late with Austin.
All right, all right. I'm your host, Jake Martin. We have a great show for you tonight. I cannot express how excited I am. I feel, you know, there's quite a few, Austin legends around. And, tonight I feel like I'm sharing the stage with one. So let's just, yeah, don't be modest.
My dad's the legend, actually.
Well, you know, you're the apple does not fall far.
I have carved a little niche for myself.
There you go. Shannon Psalm, let's just kind of get into it. I want to get as much information out tonight. For those that don't know, we're going to talk about your dad here in a minute, but I want to just kind of get to know all of you. You know, people see you guys playing. They know the songs. They know that stuff, but they don't know the personal you. So
yeah, gotcha.
Where did you grow up?
Well, I was born in Salinas. California. Okay. Born in Salinas, California. I don't know if you know the history, but in 1966, the Sir Douglas Quintet got busted in Corpus Christi for a couple of, you know, joints. Uh-huh. And we went to California, so I wasn't born yet, right? And if it wouldn't have been for that, I always try to tell people.
Oh, your name.
I would have been, with my name when I told you Shandon, yeah. California. So I was born in Salinas, and then just, you know, 69. And then in a few years later, we moved to San Antonio, and Dad went to Austin. So every on the weekends, I would see Dad at Barton Springs in the 70s. Nice. As a kid. And then on the weekdays, it was like, you know, Mom, go to school and wake up on time. So, yeah, Austin was the Uranium Savages and all those bands. It, 70s in Austin was great. And we have a song that we're going to play that reminisces about the 70s in Austin.
And let me show this real quick. Which camera are we doing? I can't see which light is on. Here we go. Or actually, let's do number this one because he can zoom in. And this is, real quickly, Psalm covers Psalm. This is you and your dad here.
Yes.
And I really wish I would have had a pearl beer to bring in and we could have done this.
And I wish I would have left the pearl beer, but I just, you know, with copyright thing. I didn't know if there's still a company or if Anheuser-Busch would, you know, it would be those guys.
Right, right.
So, yeah. But so I just had to leave it off. But still, it's good. And now we know, I don't know if you can put it up again, but Barton Wilson took that picture. Okay, and then a guy named Mark Guerra took the picture of me. This was like mid-2000s, okay? So this is 1971, and then me in mid-2000s. I don't normally dress like that, but for this concept, Psalm cover Psalm, I matched, I just didn't have a pearl can, right?
Yeah.
So, but I put it side by side, and it did Psalm covers Psalm.
Awesome. And we're going to talk to your dad, but let me talk to the rest of the band here, and we'll come back and talk more about your dad and the CD. Sir, what's your name?
Danny G.
All right. And you playing the guitar there. How long have you been playing guitar?
Probably about 30 years.
All right. Are you a native Texan or where are you from?
Close enough. Corpus Christi.
Okay. Yeah. So you grew up in Texas. Mm-hmm. When did you, how long have you been playing guitar?
Probably about 30 years and gigging for 25 plus.
So you've learned a few songs over the years.
Oh, yeah.
you're going to hear that here in a minute. Let me get back over here. Let me see how I can stand out of the way. All right. Sir, what's your name and how long have you been playing the drums and where are you from? Where'd you grow up?
I'm Gary First. I'm from Dallas, Texas. I live in Austin, Texas, San Marcos area. I've been playing drums for, I don't know how long I've been playing drums, about 50 years.
Long enough.
Something like
that. Nice.
Who
would you say is your inspiration drum-wise?
Shannon Psalm.
Well, we both love Bonham.
Oh, yeah. Let me move over here. All right. Here, come on out here in the light a little bit. There we go. All right. Now, you look real familiar.
Yeah.
And we've had you out here before.
Yes.
And tonight, you're playing bass.
Correct.
I guess you were last time, too.
I was last time, too, yeah.
go ahead and watch.
I'm not that talented. I need to only stick with one instrument.
There you go. How long have you been playing the bass?
About 20 years.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And are you a Texan?
I've lived here 20 years now. But I'm California, Arizona girl.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah.
I'm from Kansas, so, you know, I got here as soon as I could. That's what we say, right?
When
we
My mom is from Kansas.
There you go. What part?
Shawnee,
Michigan?
Yes.
Yep. Yeah. All right. Hey, I'm Wichita, Derby's in there a little bit. Cool. Phenomenal, and you're going to hear her in a while, too. Now, these I've always just absolutely loved. Let me try to get out of this way. What's your name and where are you from?
Tony Nobles. I'm from Wimberley.
Oh, nice.
Yeah.
So. I need to get back out there. There's so much to do out there.
There's a lot to do, but I wish some people would go away, man. There's too many. So.
Welcome to Wimberley. Yeah.
I'm not going to say how cool it is, man, but yeah, it's all right.
So how long have you been playing? Like, when you started, is this what you started on? Or did you start as a child? Like, when did you start playing any instrument? What was your first one?
I started playing guitar when I was maybe 14.
Okay.
And then I started playing pedal steel about 10 years ago when some friends of mine started a band because I could have a gig. And it's a lot of fun.
Yeah.
And I just play the organ here because someone has to cover Augie's parts. I'm not, you know.
Yeah.
Has to happen.
Nice. Was it hard to make the switch from regular guitar to this?
Yeah, man. It's difficult and weird and awesome all at once.
Nice. Well, you sound awesome.
I call him my Augie and Doug because Dad played steel guitar and Augie did the Farfisa, so he's covering both.
He's got many hats.
Oh yeah, and he's good. He's great. This whole band is great. I really like it.
It's like the all-star cast here. I feel like I'm very honored to have you guys out here. What's your name?
Heather Bishop.
All right. And obviously you are singing.
I am. I'm actually trained as a classical violist.
Oh, wow.
But I sing as well. And I've been playing viola for about 40 years, but singing since shortly after birth. So.
Nice. I guess, you know, you're born with the voice or you're not.
Yeah.
I mean, how hard would it be for someone that doesn't know how to sing? You could learn a little bit, but you would never be like, good unless you just have the gusto like you do.
I'm actually convinced that most people are better than they think they are.
That's true. They're shy, they're scared.
Yeah, with a little bit of coaching, with a little bit of information.
And a little bit of alcohol.
Maybe a little Dutch courage.
That's the only time I karaoke.
A little Dutch courage, sure. I think most people can sing better than they think. But, you know, you never know.
You never know. All right. Let's get back over here. Let's talk about, you know, the CD here. You know, why the CD? Why now?
Well, first of all,
let's tell them a little bit about your dad and his musical career in about like 3 minutes.
Oh, yeah. Well, actually, I'll make it just a minute because we can talk pretty fast, right? Psalms can talk fast. Dad was if you look on, you know, Wikipedia, Doug Somm, he was a child prodigy, right? And he was born in San Antonio. And if you see him in the documentary called Genuine Texas Groove, he basically grew up in an early time before he could even, so at 8, he was doing steel guitar, but he couldn't even get into the clubs yet. But T-Bone Walker, he lived on this Mexican-American, kind of African-American black side of town. Mm-hmm. And so he would hear this pumping, and so he lived close. And he would get on the steps of a box or something and just kind of feel and pulsate and before he could get into clubs. And, you know, my dad's brother always said, he came home every night and worked on his sound. So, you know, 8-year-olds, 9-year-olds, 10-year-olds, they don't really do that. They're all playing, you know, mud balls or not mud pies, but, you know, or riding bikes and skateboards. But he was doing steel guitar. And then, you know, he was one of the first bands to be disguised as being British, but they were really from San Antonio. So he broke with Sir Douglas Quintet, She's About a Mover. That was the first thing. That basically changed everything. I mean, that was, and he wasn't a one-hit wonder, because then in 69, he had another one called Mendocino. And so 65, my brother was born, and 69, I was born, and he had She's About a Mover in 65 and Mendocino in 69. So Dad used to say, isn't that weird that the two, you know, the kids, my sons that were born on the years I had hits.
There you go.
So, yeah, and he's just, you know, he put, plain and simply, put Austin music on the map. Yeah. 1969, 1970, he was here before Willie Nelson was, before any of these guys were. Yeah. And, Armadillo World Headquarters and Soap Creek were my playground. You know, there was my daycare.
Yeah.
So I was looked after by a bunch of hippies, and if you can tell, you know, it made my life better.
And for those of you watching that have no idea, you know, seriously, Google, you know.
A lot of people do. This is fertile ground for people that are watching, but there are a lot of new people.
Right.
And sometimes you can say, you ever heard of the Texas Tornadoes? And they go, yeah, or Cape Iso or whatever. And then you go, have you ever heard of Doug Somm? They go, no, I haven't. But because, you know, Dad had three things. He had a solo, which is Doug Somm. Mm-hmm. He had Sir Douglas Quintet and Texas Tornadoes. So
what was the order there?
It was then, it was Sir Douglas Quintet, then solo.
And then
well,
Tornadoes?
I actually, you know what, I have to say, it was actually Little Doug. And so it was a little bit of soloing in the 50s, but then once 64, 65 yeah. went on, so it was different after yeah. that. Before that, yes, it was Dad solo, kind of yeah. younger Doug, the teenage Doug.
Gotcha.
yeah. Then he got the She's About a Mover, and then after the Beatles and everything, and then Mendocino and everything that came after.
After that.
Yeah.
Nice. Well, I want to talk so much about your dad in the project, yeah. but I also want to get out of the way and let you play.
Yeah, yeah. And I just want to say this is a tribute. What we're doing is, so I moved to Amsterdam and got a manager and got a good little record label called Friendly Folk Records. And she was like, "Hey, put out. There's some pockets of yeah. Doug heads there too, because he's played Europe. So this is a little tribute. And then I'm gonna have new music out in February 2020 of original music on Friendly Folk Records. But this is the first start. This is our little taste. We're doing a Texas Psalm really cover Psalm fun. Tour.
And you know, it's interesting. A lot of Texas bands, musicians are huge, in other
the
places.
The Dutch, like, for sure. Yeah. They love, why? Because it's real. They love Texas music. Yeah. Oh, they talk about, "Oh, we loved your dad and Stevie Ray and Willie Nelson." Yeah. And, you know, they love it. They love it.
For good reason.
They love to come over here and they go, "I love Texas." My friend Odd, who's a good friend of Dad's, I love Texas Shandon. I love it. He wears a Texas hat when he's in Holland. So it's funny. I'm all like, Texas. Well, I'm not Texan. I was born in California, but I've lived here for almost ever. So Texas guy boasting about Holland, and he's a Holland guy boasting about Texas.
Yeah. and we're also going to get into that as to when and why you moved there. But I'm going to get out of the way so these guys can hear you guys sing. We'll be back about 2:25. Yeah, there you go. All right.
Do we start? Or
we got a little kerfuffle there.
So, doing the Psalm cover Psalm, I really love the band and they got introduced to, but they've played with me and been around, for a while, and I pick these players and I really like these guys and it really makes my job easier. So I really want to, give a big hand for my band because they sound really great. And we're going to do a song called "Is Anybody Going to San Antonio?" It's the first song off of Doug Psalm and Band. So here we go.
San Antonio, Phoenix, Arizona. can I ever know her?
Take us home, Tony. All right, is anybody, it's funny, I used to joke because I don't want to sing it, but I used to say, is anybody going to Shandon's home? Yeah. Anyways, thank y'all so much. We are going to do a song about Austin, Texas in the 70s. I know a lot of people have moved here, and here it goes. It's a first song on side A of Groover's Paradise, and it basically features Stu Cook. If people don't know this information, there's so much history. Stu Cook and Doug Cosmo Clifford, from CCR, are actually his bass and drums. So it's a Creedence record without John Fogerty and his brother, but it's got that backbeat. And here we go. This is about Austin, Texas in the 70s called Groover's Paradise. Myself a ride. Too long, Detroit City. Mind is taking a ride. Well, I wanna go back to Texas, 'cause my cowgirls play, yeah. I wanna have some fun in the good old Texas way. Down in Groover's Paradise, Groover's Paradise, Groover's Paradise. Told you one or two times, ain't gonna tell you no more. Too long to Detroit City, like it hardly breathe no more. Well, I want a whole lot of cold pearl beer, and I love the Texas style. Ooh, you got your truck on, baby, wider than a Texas mile. Down in Groover's Paradise, Groover's Paradise, Groover's Paradise. Groover's Paradise.
Groover's Paradise.
All right, two. Curl your hair, enchiladas and barbecue. Oh baby, what you gonna do? Come over here beside me, tell me how you've been, yeah. Ooh, you got your truck on, baby, wider than a Texas mile. Down in Groover's Paradise, Groover's Paradise, Groover's Paradise. All right, take us home. Paradise.
It's only rock and roll, and we like it. All right, we got, I think we're going to get good for another one we're going to play here, is a Texas Tornado song. So back in the day, way back in 1988, there was four guys, Freddie Fender, Flaco Jimenez, Doug Somm, and Augie Myers. And this was one of their songs. They had many hits, but here's one of them. Stranger or a close friend of mine. You didn't want to it, then I put into it last night. Who were you thinking of when we were loving last night? Well, who were you thinking of when I was making love to you? There was a smile on your face I hadn't seen in some time. You got more out of it than I put into it last night. Who were you thinking of when we were loving last night? All right, here it goes. Do it, Tony. Stranger or a close friend of mine. You didn't wanna quit when we was into it last night. Who were you thinking of when we were loving last night? Let's do it again. Take us home, Tony. This is about the place I live. About 2 years ago, I sold my house in Austin, Texas. Couldn't afford the property taxes. And I went, hey, I just want to never lived outside the United States. So this song is about Amsterdam. And a lot of Dad's fans really like this one. So check it out. Well, we packed all rusty guitar cases. Kiss the kids and make the airport on the run. Even after 4 or 5 years of steady rocking. Well, it's goodbye San Francisco. Hello Amsterdam. We cut this record down in Houston. It was a smash and the boys became a star. Even after 4 or 5 years of steady rocking. Well, it's goodbye San Francisco. Hello Amsterdam. Amsterdam, Amsterdam, I hear you call. crawling. Will it?
Goodbye, San Francisco. Hello, Amsterdam.
Third verse.
'Cause all my friends back in California, it's not the place that I wanna be. Even after 4 or 5 years of steady rocking, well, it's goodbye, yo, key continent. Hello, Golden Gate Park. Amsterdam, Amsterdam, I hear you calling. Grooving with the girls along the canal. Amsterdam, Amsterdam, I hear you calling. Take it over, Heather.
That's my exit point.
Yeah, right.
All right. You know, I've lived in Austin a very long time.
Yeah.
And I've been to your dad's, the little thing, Doug Somm in Butler Park. And, you know, I just today, because I was looking up some stuff, I was like, I've been there a million times, taking a million pictures. Never knew that was after your dad. What's how did that happen?
Yeah. It was something
awesome,
that we,
by the way.
Yeah, it was something that we did in November of 09. And we, me, my brother, and my sister, we went, you know, and talked to the city council. And, you know, kind of, a lot of them knew who dad was.
Yeah.
But, you know, for the few people that didn't, we had to say, well, you know, he did this, and he was real important to the Austin music scene, and da-da. And they were totally cool about it. And then actually, people at the Butler Park were actually like, hey, well, you know. So like we were talking about, I don't know if it was if that thing was there first, but we christened it, you know, Doug Somm Hill.
That's awesome.
And I remember that the Butler people that owned it were really nice about it. They're like, yeah, you know. And so I want to thank the Butler family that owns Butler Park for keeping that in there. Hopefully it'll be there forever, just like the Stevie Ray Vaughan statue. They can go and walk and see Stevie Ray and then walk across the street and see and hang out on Doug Somm Hill.
Yeah, and for those of you that don't know, it's that little circle that you kind of go up and climb a little hill, and it has the best view of downtown Austin. Yeah. I mean the best. It's
pretty much across
from the
water thing that comes up. It's like you can see it from...
Phenomenal.
Yeah. That's great, you know, because dad really did. He blood, sweat, and tears, you know, in 1970, Armadillo and Soap Creek, you know, he was here first. He was the first Cosmic Cowboy pioneer guy doing it in 1968, you know. Even before we lived here, he was already having that look that a lot of people do now.
Yeah.
And then Willie Nelson came along in 72 and 73. Yeah. So I just want people to know the history really is dad was there first. He was like the blueprint of the Cosmic Cowboy.
Way for these people.
Oh, totally. Yeah. And helped put, you know, he was ruling here in the early 70s. And then, you know, Willie Nelson comes along and kind of now we're okay.
Yeah.
But it was that time, like Willie actually saw this and went, hey, this is a cool crowd. Yeah. I think and the rest is history. You know,
awesome.
So dad always was good at making things happen. You know, he was at the good, he was talented, but he was in those right places with Janis and out in San Francisco in 66, you know, hanging out with Grateful Dead and then Dylan. And, you know, it would take part 2, 3, 4, and 5 to go through the whole history of Doug Somm.
Right. So. And, you know, speaking of right time and right place, how and why Amsterdam?
Well, you know, if people don't know, I've toured in the Meat Puppets for the last 10 years. And I've always been there. I actually went there with dad one time in 96, but then I got the travel bug in 07. I started going a bunch. And I just, one of those kind of things when you're like, wow, what would it be like to live here? Mm-hmm. And when I sold my house, that was that time. Hey, do I want to get another house out in Leander, you know, or something, a place that's cheaper out there? Mm-hmm. Or do I want to just go and just live the adventure and see what happens? Mm-hmm. And I'm on the adventure now. It's been like 2 years, you know, and everything's just been happening in a good, positive way. Everything, you know, fits, been fitting. You know, I had Danny and Gary are played with me the longest, and then I had Tony. But I just knew everybody, not only just the three core of these guys were great and that they've played this music before.
Yeah.
But just everybody I picked, it was the right pick. Yeah. It felt good. You know, we don't have any, we've all dealt in bands where we've had something where you sometimes wasn't always, you know, merry, but you know what I mean, as far as, and so now being like the leader of doing this, I just want to have a good vibe with everybody, and we love to play, and that's what it's about. I mean, that's why we do it, and I just want my band, because I've done a lot of stuff, you know, and so have they, but I want them to feel like the rock stars that they are, because they are rock stars, you know. I mean, to me, a rock star is somebody that pays their dues,
right?
Not just somebody that sells millions of records,
right? And, you know, you're out there doing the thing there, and you talk about Rockstar playing at ACL Fest.
Yeah.
Not a bad gig.
Well, I want to say musician first, Rockstar second.
Okay.
But, yes.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay. But, yeah.
So how does that come about? That's
Brandon.
I mean, that's not a hard, you know.
Well, you know, Brandon at C3, and I've known Charles Atal for a long time, but I've never talked to him in a long time. He just kind of wrote on Facebook, Brandon, and he was just like, hey, really like your dad. Let's see if I can maybe get you on the small stage.
Nice.
And here's the thing I told him, because I didn't want him to think I was bratty or I didn't want any favors, you know. I just wanted to play a cool rock and roll show.
Right.
That's all. I wanted these guys to have fun, big rock stage. Because I've done a lot of that, and so have they. But it's just fun to do those
kinds
of shows.
It's cool to come back in your hometown, and ACL Fest is so big.
I love Austin now that I don't live here. I really, it makes me really appreciate it.
Yeah.
I do, and I'm going to come back. See, you can't come see me. I'm doing like 3.5 weeks in Texas, but you can't come see me like next month or whatever. You know, well, you can see me a few places, like November 3rd. But after I'm gone on the 8th, I'm gone for 6 months or 8 months.
Yeah.
And I'm going to try and do this once a year or twice a year. I just don't know yet.
Yeah.
But it's great, and, you know, I love the playing with the guys. I wish I could get these guys over there.
Yeah.
You know, but hey, like I told Danny, we're still building it. You know, I've got a little bit of leverage with, you know, the Meat Puppets and doing what I've done and being a son of, but you're always still building it. You know, you don't ever just go, oh, okay, all right, I did the Meat Puppets. Everything's just going to, you know, you still got to work for it. Nothing good comes easy. You know?
You've been working
I wish
for
I knew that when
time.
I was 20. Yeah. I wish I knew all that like when I was 20.
You've been working for it for a while. You did Meat
a long
Puppets.
Time.
Was Meat Puppets your first kind of big deal?
No, Pariah.
Pariah.
Do you know the Sims Foundation, right?
Yeah.
That's my bass player, Sims Ellison, that committed suicide.
And that's a San Antonio, like
Well, we started in San Antonio. Okay. We went to Clark High School, and it was the Ellison brothers. It was Kyle Ellison and Sims Ellison and me. And me and Kyle were in the same grade, and Sims was a few years older, so he was a senior. And he asked me to play drums. And there you go. We had, and then from there, we got, you know, a singer. Because I started off as a singer-drummer. But we we couldn't find the right singer. We found the right singer, and then we found the right guitar player. And right out of high school, about 2 years later, we got signed to Geffen, you know?
Yeah.
And so that was during the Guns N' Roses kind of thing.
Yeah.
And then our album came out a little too late. But I never quit. Like, that was a pivotal point, because that got thrown to me so quick. Like, okay, we got in this band that we're friends, and we, you know, swim in his swimming pool, and then we practice, right?
Yeah.
We just did that. And then it kind of got, oh, it's a job, right, and everything.
Right.
And had I, at that point, when Pariah kind of broke up and what happened with Sims, are you a rock star? Are you in this for a rock star? Are you in it to be a musician? You know, that was a little pivoting point. And I said, well, I'm a musician. This is, I do music.
Yeah.
And then, you know, a little bit later, I started writing, or I got the thing to play with the Meat Puppets. Then a couple years later after that, because that, the first incarnation, see, I was in the band twice.
Ah.
It's a long history. But then I played Gibby's Haynes solo record. Then I got called back a few years later due to the Meat Puppets. And then in 2017, I moved. And here we are now.
Okay.
So to catch you up on everything.
Yeah, I mean, I love that history. It's great. And people are going to be Googling all this stuff.
Yeah, please do. Google and you know, Instagram.
And, you
got the stuff at the bottom. So
with Meat Puppets, if people know you as Meat Puppets, and now they're seeing you play guitar, like, when do you make the leap from drums to guitar? Do you want to, like, sing more and do more songwriting? So you, like, why and how?
They're both their own worlds, you know, and you have to learn the, you know, what do you call it? The little, what makes it tick on each world. And so I'm still figuring it out, but it is natural. But I started on the drums, and there was a time period where I was landing really good gigs as a drummer, and I didn't really have the time until I had a little bit of time off to, like, oh, and, you know, Kurt would say, from the Meat Puppets. He said, hey, you can play guitar. Hey, that little idea you're playing that you're singing is a good idea. You ever recorded it? So it was a little bit of my good friends kind of pushing me. And then the first couple of solo CDs I did were kind of experimental, just if I could play with myself, playing with myself, you know, tightly, because I would play the drums, right? And then you put the bass down, and then you put the guitar down, right?
Yeah, layer,
and
layer.
Once I did that, I was like, okay, I can kind of do it. But I like both worlds. Like I said, I love this band so much that if we were to go in the studio tomorrow, this is what we would do.
Yeah.
Now that I've got this, you know, but you have to make do with the circumstances you're around. So, you know, but I kind of digressed a little bit. What was your point?
Do you prefer guitar or drum? Where do you feel most comfortable? Because you made this switch, but you started on drums, so.
I'm most comfortable playing music, period. Okay. Now, drums, yes. Is it like the back of my hand? Yeah. And I've been doing it for so long that I can do things and maybe... that they, the normal people wouldn't know that I'm kind of relaxing, or, you know. But no, with this, I kind of have to really get into it.
You try harder on the guitar than...
Yeah, but you know what? Kurt from the Meat Puppets had a saying, and it's so true. Like, what we're doing here with these songs, there are a few songs, kind of the chords over, and we want to make the simple rock. And I think that's what we've accomplished. Kurt used to say, if you think, you stink. And I understand that philosophy. Yeah. It's really like... I mean, I don't mind, like, hey, at the end, we might want to go ba-ba-bum and stuff, you know.
Yeah.
But if you're thinking too much and you're like, oh, God, when's the next verse coming? Oh, you know, whoa. And, oh, I think this is the bridge. I don't, you know, if you're doing that, then your timing or your bass, whatever it is you know. I never have any kind of stage fright or no problem with any of that as long as I'm rehearsed.
Yeah.
As long as I know what I'm doing, I let everything take over, you know? Right. I mean, that's what rock and roll is all about.
People
don't understand that there's a power. There is power in rock music.
Yes.
And that's what it got me as a kid, you know, seeing like Kiss Alive 2 opening up the thing and then hearing, you know, you wanted the best. And then
you got the best.
Because I lived in two worlds. I lived in the blues world in Austin and, you know, the Antones and all that, right? But then when I was growing as a teenager, we went to see the big arena shows like Kiss and Rush and all that. So I lived in two worlds, you know?
That's awesome. I'm going to get out of the way. We're going to do this world. We're going to do more Psalm cover Psalm.
That's all. This is all nothing. All Doug and nothing but.
There you go.
Oh. Well, except for this one.
Oh, okay. Let me see.
Gonna wake up one morning before the sun reaches dawn. You're gonna wake up one morning before the sun reaches dawn. You're gonna look around, look around, girl. You're gonna find out I'm gone. Then you realize, then you realize, then you realize. So you don't want my love. Cause you don't need it. Cause you don't want my love. Sit around wondering, find yourself all alone. Don't try to stop me, baby. I ain't coming home. I ain't coming home. I ain't coming home. Two, uno, dos, tres, cuatro. Miss me.
Rocky, we love you. Dad and Rocky did the two-headed dog thing in the 70s, and it's really known, you know, people that love Rocky love that two-headed dog 70s thing. So that was for you, Rocky. We love you. For Dad, Freddie Fender, all the people that aren't here that are awesome and made Texas music great. And internationally, they spread this music international too, so. All right, well, you know what? Let's give them, you know, it's getting close, right, to what, Halloween? So maybe we need to give them some candy, you know, some musical candy, since we can't deliver it to your door right now. I think, what do you call it? Let's do, Gary. Give me a drum roll, please. Please rise if you're at home for the San Antonio National Anthem. Hey, baby, que pasó? Thought I was your only vato.
Hey, baby, que pasó?
Won't you give me a cool peso? Come on, baby, turn around. Let me see your pretty blue eyes. Don't you know that I love you? And my thoughts are always real.
Hey, baby, ¿qué pasó?
Thought I was your only vato.
Hey, baby, ¿qué pasó?
Won't you give me un peso? All right, Tony. So, all right, verse. So come on, baby, turn around. Let me see your pretty blue eyes. Don't you know, quintaquero? Please don't leave me desamoto. Sing it in TV land.
Hey, baby, ¿qué pasó?
Thought I was your only vato.
Hey, baby, ¿qué pasó?
Won't you give me food? Kiss Alive 2. We got a little surprise for you tonight. I'm handing the guitar over to Tony Nobles for Wasted Days and Wasted Nights. Yeah, I know. It's like, you know, Ace Frehley and Doug, you know, my influences. Dad took me to meet Kiss in 79, and it ruined my life, if you can't tell. All right. All right. Oh, that sounds kind of cool, actually. All right, here we go. Wasted days and wasted nights. I have left all you behind. Though you don't belong to me, your heart belongs to someone else. Why should I keep loving you when I know you're not true? Why should I call your name when you're to blame for making me blue? Don't you thank you. should I keep loving you when I know you're not true? And why should I call your name when you're to blame for making me blue? All right, give us a nice solo. Yeah, we got the last, saved the best for last here. Well, it was, it's all good, but the two more. Oh, okay. Two more.
Let's do, here we go. Let's do. You know what? But she's about a move, we kind of like play around a little bit, so if that could, we could make that kind of into one longer one. That's, is that all right?
Let's try that.
Oh, yeah. Thank you, Danny.
Hey, I'm really lucky to have these guys, this band. I really love it. When you have a good band, they make your job or the front man's job easier. They just do.
Now we get hired again.
Advice, musician advice 101. Okay, here we go. This song has been in many soundtracks, riding in cars with boys and all sorts of things. And it was 1965. Changed everything for Dad. And it goes like this. That Augie Meyer keyboard. Yeah. right rock and roll guitar game.
You guys practiced that tune before?
Nah, never. I've never heard it, actually.
Yeah, you winged it really good.
Yeah. For not ever practicing it our first time,
that was pretty good. So, in Holland, what are you doing? Are you solo gigging? Do you have?
In Holland, I've been doing kind of acoustic thing by myself because I haven't really, I'm hitting certain things there. And a lot of the gigs I have are, I've been doing like record stores and like concerto records because they all have dad in their bins, you know?
Yeah.
And, so I just do the whole thing, like, they don't know me, I don't know them, and, hey, you have Soto's Quartet? Yeah, we do, I love them, whatever, and I was like, he's my dad, and they're like, really? And they're like, you want to play here? I'm like, sure.
So that's how
that happened.
Yeah.
I haven't really, it ain't like here a little bit, it's a little more fertile here, but there are pockets, I'll be.
Yeah, so is it hard to, I mean.
No, it's not, because, I kind of went to change the whole environment, right? I was kind of tired of, congestion and strip malls and stuff, and I wanted to see, as an artist, I wanted to be surrounded by art and music.
Yeah.
And that was just my time, I had the money to do it, and. So I went for it.
If I'm going to Amsterdam anytime soon.
Som tour guide, I'll take you around.
Okay.
Som tour packages available.
So if I do this, what do I need to see in Amsterdam? What's like a must? Hmm. I mean, I'm sure there's like two places that you're like, Jake, you got to go here.
Well, I mean, it depends on what you like to do. For people that like to party and people that don't like to party, it depends. If you're into architecture, you would love architecture. If you're into canals and boats and stuff and things like that, you would love that. If you're into coffee shop smoking, having a smoke, you like that. If you like to participate in legal prostitution, you can go to the red light district.
Gotcha.
It's just a very open, place, and it's a very adult kind of place. 18, you can drink and smoke in Europe at 18 because they just seem a little more mature about that. They're not so You know?
Yeah, we can't show nipples here and stuff.
Oh, my God. Well, I've learned that this is a very Puritan country. They don't have a lot of things I've seen over there they would not have, and that's not anything political. They would have them on the billboards here. Yeah. I could, you know, if we had the time, I'd break it out on my phone. Yeah. I'd show you some of these pictures, you know. But it's just, it's just a little bit more open like that. I'm just, as an artist, I wanted to be surrounded by art and music.
Yeah.
Now, having said that, coming back here, we are a little bit, I can tell that, you know, we're all a little bit spoiled with all the good music that's here. There's a lot. Yeah. So in Dutch, they're like, shh, you know, we want to watch, or, you know, they're here.
Oh. You know, we kind of take it for granted.
Oh, it's more about a scene here. It's like,
talking,
hey, you like the band? Hey, you're pretty cute. Yeah. You know, what you, you know, like I'm rocking out too to try to hit on you. It's more of a scene. And more over there's just, a little bit more about the music. A little bit more. If there's five people in the audience, if they love you, those five people will follow you. Yeah. Not that they won't hear, but there's something old school about it over there. Right. They're like, that's what it is. Yeah.
That's cool. I gotta get over there. We got
I'll show you around. Okay, so Rijksmuseum, Van Gogh Museum, you know, Dam Square. It depends. You like boat rides, you can go in canals and it just depends if you like architecture, if you like to party. It depends on what your thing is, because it's good. It's cool for people that like to party. But I know moms and things that have been like, I just love it.
Coffee
because it's, because it's the architecture is amazing. Everywhere you walk, Van Gogh would be walking right around the corner. You can just imagine him going, oh, hi, you know.
There we go. We got a few seconds. I just want to shake everybody's hand. Thank you guys
for
coming out. Really, seriously, a privilege.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you for having us. I really appreciate that. You know, it's a pleasure to be able to play and spread Dad's music, and thank you for helping keeping Dad's music alive. Everybody out there. All right, thank you.
Thank you, guys.
Bye-bye.
We'll see you next week.